In this lecture, we're going to talk a little bit more about the kinds of information we get out of a parametrization, its first derivative, and also its second derivative. So we haven't seen that yet, but we'll take a look at the second derivative, r double prime, in this lesson. So let's look at the plane curve, r of t equals cosine of t sine of t, for t values between 0 and 2 pi. We know that this vector-valued function is going to trace out the familiar unit circle in R2. So we're going to revolve around the unit circle once in a counterclockwise fashion. Let me imagine that I've picked some input t0, and suppose r of t0 is this vector here. Notice the x-coordinate is cosine of t0, and the y-coordinate is sine of t0. The velocity vector at that point would be the vector we get by evaluating r prime of t0. So that's going to be r prime. And then of course we just differentiate component by component. So the derivative of cosine is negative sine. Plug in t0 and we get negative sine of t0, cosine of t0. Notice the sine of the input is the y value for this point, and the cosine of the input is the x value. So I could also think of this as negative y comma x. So if this is the point x comma y, the coordinates of the velocity vector would be negative y comma x. I could graph that vector in standard position like this. But it's going to be more illustrative to take that vector and place it tangent to the curve. So this vector is our velocity vector r prime at t0. It lies tangent to the curve at that point, and it points us in the direction that we're traveling. So since we're going counterclockwise, we expect the velocity vector to point us in that direction. It points us in a way that agrees with the motion around this curve. Speed is the magnitude of velocity. So speed is a scalar value that we get by computing the length of r prime at t0. That's going to be the square root of negative sine squared plus cosine squared, so we're going to get a speed of 1. That would be true for any input along this curve, so we say that this is a unit speed parametrization. For any input, our velocity vector has length 1, so the speed of this parametrization is 1. It's a unit speed parametrization. Okay, then the acceleration is the second derivative of r of t, so we get r double prime of t is negative cosine of t, negative sine of t. And if we relate that back to our x and y coordinates, we see that's actually negative x, negative y. It's actually negative r of t. So if I want to sketch this vector, I could start at the point on the curve and point directly back to the origin. The acceleration vector for a parametrization does not always point directly opposite of the original vector like this one does, but it does point kind of into the bend. So we're sort of bending around the tail of this vector. That's the velocity vector, speed, and acceleration for this particular parametrization of the unit circle, but we're going to look now at a new parametrization to see how these quantities might change. The question I want you to ask yourself is, are quantities like speed intrinsic to the curve, meaning just based on the shape of the curve regardless of how you parametrize it, or do they depend on the parametrization? Do two parametrizations of the same curve give you the same speed? Given any curve parametrized by r of t, you can always parametrize it a little bit differently. In fact, there are infinitely many ways to parametrize a curve. If you have a parametrization and you change it, that's called reparametrizing a curve. And how would you change it? Well, you would take your input t and plug in, say, a strictly increasing differentiable function f of tau. So tau is going to be our new input. We plug f of tau into the original parametrization. So if I plug f of tau into our original parametrization r, it's going to look like this. And then sometimes in this course, we might denote this new parametrization as r sub 1 of tau, kind of removing the intermediary function f. Okay, so we started with r of t, and then we're going to replace t with f of tau to get a new parametrization. This is called reparametrizing our original curve. Okay, let's reparametrize our circle. So we started with r of t equals cosine comma sine for t values going from 0 to 2 pi. That swept out the curve once in a counterclockwise fashion. Now I'm going to take the increasing function f of tau equals tau cubed and reparametrize the unit circle. So our new parametrization r sub 1 of tau will be r of f of tau, which is going to be r of tau cubed. Now I look at my original parametrization and I sub in tau cubed everywhere I have t. So we get cosine of tau cubed, sine of tau cubed. We want to trace out the exact same curve. I want to have the same starting point and the same ending point. So I would like for this parametrization to go one time around the unit circle in a counterclockwise fashion. That means that we need to take our bounds from 0 to 2 pi and adjust them because those were the bounds for t, not for tau. So our starting input was taking cosine of 0, sine of 0. So when is tau cubed equal to 0? Well, that means tau is 0. So our starting bound is actually going to stay at 0. Then the upper bound needs to correspond to having cosine of 2 pi, sine of 2 pi. So we need tau so that tau cubed is 2 pi. So that means tau would have to be the cube root of 2 pi. Okay, so to summarize, our reparametrization is going to be r sub 1 of tau is cosine of tau cubed, sine of tau cubed, for tau values from 0 to cube root of 2 pi. Like this, we have reparametrized the unit circle. Okay, let's compare the velocity, speed, and acceleration for these two parametrizations. The first one is our standard parametrization of the unit circle, and the second one is the reparametrization that we just did. So from before, we've already calculated the velocity, speed, and acceleration for the original unit circle. So let me just write those down. Okay, so here's the velocity, speed, and acceleration for our standard parametrization of the unit circle. I made a couple remarks here. The speed is always 1, so this is a unit speed parametrization. And also the acceleration vector had that neat property that it was exactly negative the original position vector. Okay, let me recompute these quantities for the new parametrization. So first I'll do r prime. So just differentiating term by term and using the chain rule, we get this vector. Whenever possible, if I have a scalar that's common to the components of a vector, I like to pull it in front of the vector. So let me pull that 3 tau squared out in front. Now I can compute the speed of this parametrization by taking the length of this vector. And you know what, I just realized I should call this r sub 1 of tau. It doesn't make sense to call it r of t. There we go. Okay, so let's fix that. And now we're going to take the speed, so r sub 1 of tau prime, that vector's length. That's going to be the length of a scalar times a vector. So this is actually easy once you've pulled that scalar out front. So let me write 3 tau squared times the vector negative sine tau cubed cosine tau cubed. Three tau squared is a non-negative scalar that stays in front when you're computing length. And then negative sine squared of tau cubed plus cosine squared of tau cubed is really just negative sine squared plus cosine squared. It's going to be 1. So overall, the speed is 3 tau squared. Notice that depends on tau. This is not a unit speed parametrization. As tau increases, our parametrization is going to speed up. Okay, lastly, let me compute the acceleration. You can either differentiate the vector that we originally wrote down for r1 prime, or you can do the product rule with the scalar and the vector. I think I'll do the latter method, so let me do 6 tau times the vector plus 3 tau squared times the derivative of the vector. Let me leave it as two vectors. The first one is as simple as it's going to get, and the second one I'll factor out that 3 tau squared. So here's the acceleration. Not too much to say here, except that it no longer has the property that it's negative the original position vector, right? So that was somewhat special to the original parametrization that we had for the unit circle. Okay, so now we're ready to answer the question, is speed independent of parametrization? Is speed just somehow built into the shape of the curve and it doesn't matter how you parametrize it? And the answer is no, because here we have a constant speed parametrization, happens to also be unit speed, but mainly the speed is constant. Whereas with our reparametrization, the speed changes as tau changes. So speed depends on the parametrization. Let me actually show you now a MATLAB demonstration of these two curves. Okay, here's the unit circle. The first thing I'm going to do is just start with the standard parametrization cosine comma sine. So what I'm going to do now is plot r of t and r prime of t for t values going from 0 to 2 pi with 100 vectors, or 100 time values. Okay, so as we revolve around the unit circle in a counterclockwise fashion, you can see these velocity vectors all have the same length. The tangent vectors are constant length. In fact, it's length 1 because this is a unit speed parametrization. Okay, now we're going to do the same thing for the second parametrization. Okay, we revolved around the circle, and the speed that we revolved around didn't change because MATLAB is plotting 100 vectors one after the other, but you can see that the velocity vectors are now really different. In fact, let me zoom out. Okay, now as we go around the unit circle, notice that the velocity vectors are getting longer each time. They're still tangent, they're still pointing in the direction of motion, but as tau increases, the length of these vectors increases. I want to make one final observation in this lesson, and that is that if you look at the velocity vector and the acceleration vector for the original parametrization, they were orthogonal. So the velocity vector here and the acceleration vector, which was pointing from the curve back towards the origin, these are perpendicular vectors. Turns out that that always happens when you have a constant speed curve. This particular parametrization was a unit speed curve, but as long as your speed is constant, you're going to have this property that velocity and acceleration are perpendicular. Here's why that happens. Let's call this constant speed c. If c, just some number, is the speed, then we can write c is the length of the velocity vector. Now square both sides and we get c squared is the length squared. But the length of a vector squared is the same thing as that vector dotted with itself. What we now have is c squared is r prime dot r prime. Let's differentiate both sides of this equality with respect to t. The derivative of the left-hand side is the derivative of a constant with respect to t, but that's just 0. And then the derivative of the right-hand side is going to follow the product rule. So we get derivative of the first dot the second, plus the first dot derivative of the second, or in other words, r double prime of t dot r prime of t plus r prime of t dot r double prime of t. But dot product is commutative, so I can flip the order of the first one and write this as twice r prime dot r double prime. Now divide both sides by 2 and you get that the dot product of the velocity vector and the acceleration vector is 0. And then two vectors have a dot product of zero if they're orthogonal. So whenever we've parametrized a curve with a constant speed parametrization, that means that the velocity and the acceleration are going to be perpendicular. Okay, that finishes this lesson. Thank you for your attention.